All right. It's a little loud. Let's bow our heads and pray before we open our Bibles. Our Father in heaven, we do believe you when you say these things have been recorded and preserved for our good. Teach us what you intend us to know by your grace this morning. I thank you for the consistent work of the prophets through these narratives, men called to speak truth and call for eyes to look to you. I ask that you'd encourage your prophets in our generation, those who are pastors and teachers, that you would sustain and refresh them by your Spirit. Speak to us, open our eyes to your grace in the passage and in our own lives. You are patient, and you give your people much more than we deserve. You are good, and you do good. You are full of grace and full of mercy. We offer our attention this morning to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Now, you probably don't use that word in your everyday conversation. The dictionary defines a wretch as a person with despicable character. And I wonder if you stopped for a minute and thought about that, whether you know somebody today with despicable character. Maybe in public life, maybe an acquaintance in your community, or maybe even someone close to you. Well, John Newton, who wrote this classic hymn, as many might know, is not exaggerating when he refers to himself as a wretch. He was known as the great blasphemer. He reached such lows at one point he was involved in the slave trade that brought slaves from Africa to England, and he admitted that he treated those slaves poorly. Among the other sailors, he had a reputation for profanity, coarseness, and debauchery, which means excessive indulgence in sensual pleasures. Newton seemed to be a person beyond hope. He seemed to be a person beyond saving. But God's amazing grace was offered to this rude, profane, slave trading, wretched sailor and transformed him into a child of God. John Newton never ceased to stand in awe of God's work of grace in his life. Now, you may not have that kind of background, but you and I also received much more than we deserve, and we should never cease to stand in awe of God's work of grace in our life. Grace gives people who appear to be beyond saving what they do not deserve, and that's what is so amazing. God is a God who moves toward fallen humanity. He moves toward those ready to turn their eyes to him. And even before they're ready, he's moving toward them and drawing them. Believers also, the wretch needs grace, but believers also need grace. And we see that in Elijah's life. He probably wouldn't be described as a wretch, but rather a faithful servant who hits rock bottom. From a courageous man of God to a man consumed with fear for his life and ready to give up. Quite a slide. But God meets him where he is and offers grace to his needy prophet. So King Ahab in chapters 20 and 21 might be closer to a John Newton type. He might be considered beyond saving. But God continues to offer him grace as well. Two men with two very different responses to God's offer of grace. So our big idea is pretty simple. God offers grace to all, but not all receive it. God offers grace to all, but not all receive it. And then the outline is division one, the weary faithful in chapter 19. And then division two, the proud faithless in chapters 20 and 21. So let's open our Bibles to 1 Kings 19. You might want to, either now or in your groups, pull out your map and kind of trace Elijah's journeys. But in this division of the weary faithful, there's an image that kind of, I think, Brittany. The journey is too much for me. I saw this image and I thought, I think everyone in this room can relate to feeling like that. That's kind of a visual of what Elijah was feeling. If you've ever felt this way, it's like you're saying, whatever it is that you're facing, your little boatload of children, whatever your circumstances are, you just feel it's more than you are equipped to handle. So this is where we find Elijah in chapter 19. We left him in a place of amazing and miraculous victory. God had been showing himself to be the one true God in all his power and glory. And he was using Elijah as his chosen instrument. He provided for him personally through the widow, and even using him to raise the widow's son from the dead. And then also before a great crowd of false prophets. And remember, the showdown was dramatic and showed without a shadow of a doubt whose God was alive and true. Well, when Jezebel heard from her husband all that Elijah had done, her message to him was, I will make your life like one of those prophets that you killed by tomorrow. In light of everything that Elijah had witnessed, this threat should not have meant much to him. He should have been able to laugh and say, show me. But in fear, he runs 120 miles from Jezreel. I got to be pretty afraid to run that many miles, right? In fear, he runs that way. Okay, so on your map, you see Jezreel, and he runs all the way down to Beersheba in Judah. Jezreel is where our scene begins this week, and in fear, he runs, where he leaves his servant in Beersheba and continues south to the desert of Zin, where he sits and has his little pity party, has a bit of a breakdown, praying that the Lord would take his life. I've had enough. I can't do it anymore. What he's experiencing is extreme psychological fatigue, physical depletion, and depression. And now, before you read this and you think smugly, well, if I had witnessed what he did, I would never end up in this condition. Let's be honest. This kind of thing happens to us. Maybe not as dramatically. Maybe the drama is a little less, but the same concept is true. We know what's true about God. Maybe we've been in the church for lots of years. We know God hears our prayers. We know he never forsakes us. We know a lot of things, a lot of truth about God. And yet, we can slide into the depths of despair. One Bible scholar said that, and this is speculation because the scripture doesn't tell us, but he suggested that the cause of this depression for Elijah could have been the realization that even after this amazing display of God's power, that the northern kingdom was not going to turn away from Baal, was not going to turn away from idol worship, and would remain subject to judgment. His expectations could have been that after such a victory, such a display, that Ahab and Jezebel would bow their knees in humility before the true and living God. But that didn't happen. And so his conclusion was, all of my faithful service to the Lord has been useless. Nothing changed. There was no confession of sin. There really wasn't much of any kind of revival. There was just a death threat. Do you have a loved one or a friend who's turned away from the truth, turned away from the gospel? No matter how long you've prayed for them, no matter how much you seek to have conversation about spiritual things with them, nothing seems to change. That can be discouraging. That can be discouraging. And what we see happen next is an example of God moving toward those who need him with grace. The angel brings bread and water to refresh the weary prophet, and he sleeps. The ESV said the angel brought him cake. I liked that. But when we're exhausted and faint, it's easy. We're vulnerable to take our focus off of the God who sees us and cares for us and become consumed with our situation, with our suffering, and our human perspective on the events in our life. Especially vulnerable when you're tired and when you're depleted. But God sits on his throne, and we can trust that he is good. And he offers grace to his servant who is exhausted. In case any, another valuable reason for this narrative to be recorded for us is that if, as a Bible student, you are tempted to misinterpret Elijah as a superhero of faith, this scene reminds us that he is just like us. He is a human being. He is a man just like us. The human condition predisposes us to fatigue, feelings of defeat and inadequacy, and wrong thinking that's driven by our feelings and not by truth. This predisposition comes from living in a fallen world. This kind of suffering might not come as a result of sin, but it's because of the presence of sin's damage in the world as a whole. Rather than being a disappointment to God in these moments, God draws near and uses these seasons to develop our longing for more of him. He proves faithful to us. He finds us. He sees us and he finds us and he offers grace. He meets us where we are and sits his presence with us. Even though Elijah was greatly used by God, he was subject to exhaustion and weakness. God met him with grace and mercy, as well as rest and refreshment. God knows we're weak and graciously cares for us in our weakness. Maybe Elijah should have known better. He should have known enough about God's power not to entertain these feelings of defeat. But God doesn't scold him. He doesn't shame him. He doesn't shun him. He provides strength and help and refreshment. So now, strengthened by the food, verse 8 tells us, chapter 19, verse 8, so he got up, ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. Mount Horeb is the same as Mount Sinai. It is 250 miles south So 40 days and 40 nights, prescribed by God, a prolonged quiet time by himself with God. And God asks Elijah one of those questions that he asks us but doesn't really need to know the answer. Elijah, where are you? What are you doing here, Elijah? Verse 10, I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I'm the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me too. God, I'm discouraged. I did everything I knew to do, raising my family, and now they've walked away from you. When I evaluate things, it's discouraging. God doesn't leave Elijah alone to suffer and to be discouraged. He engages him. And he says, why are you here? Tell me why. Tell me what you're feeling. Pour out your heart to me. And that's what Elijah does. God welcomes that. When we are exhausted and discouraged and feeling defeated, he says, pour out your heart to me. Tell me how you're feeling. And then Elijah is instructed to go, stand in the mountain, and wait for the Lord to pass by. First, a destructive wind, then an earthquake and a fire, all displays of his mighty power. But it is in the gentle whisper that prompted Elijah to cover his face, recognizing he was in the holy presence of the Lord. Then verses 15 to 21 describe God's gracious invitation for Elijah to turn his eyes back to him and join him in his work. He is instructed that, Elijah, you're not finished. You're not disqualified. He wants him to anoint two kings and the prophet Elisha, who will succeed him. And oh, and by the way, there are 7,000 comprising a faithful remnant who will not bow the knee to Baal. You are not alone, as you may wrongly surmise. Elijah, you're not alone. An encouragement from God for Elijah to adjust his thinking. Adjust your thinking. And that happens for us every single time we open our Bibles. God often applies his truth to our heart and our circumstances and adjusts our thinking when we veer. God's grace includes us in his work, even though it will be hard. He needs absolutely nothing from us to accomplish all of his purposes, but he knows that we will experience more of him when we align our hearts with his work. So Elijah goes and finds Elisha, who's plowing a field with a team of oxen. And by covering his cloak on him, that was an invitation to serve the Lord with him. Elisha proves by his action that he's leaving his old life and ready to follow and serve with Elijah. He says goodbye to his parents, slaughters his livestock, burns his equipment, and gives the meat to his neighbors. He was ready and fully committed to serve. Elijah was not alone. Here's the first principle. God's grace sustains and strengthens weak vessels for his purpose. God's grace sustains and strengthens weak vessels for his purpose. After great victories and usefulness, Elijah entered a time of discouragement. God in his grace gives his servant a new assignment and everything that he will need to fulfill the purpose. He adjusts perspective and reviews what is true. Elijah was not alone. God's presence was with him. There was a faithful remnant who would not worship false gods, and Elisha, who would succeed him, was ready to obey. There had been prophets before Elijah, and there will be prophets after Elijah. Elisha would be Israel's next prophet, and Elijah had the privilege to be the one to teach and train him. God sustains us for our part and strengthens us to prepare for the future. Elijah was not the center of God's work. He had a part in God's work for a season. It's only in his strength that his strength equipping his servants that his plan prevails. We have a season on this earth to be his witnesses and to do his work for the good of his people and for his glory. Elijah was a faithful prophet by God's grace and in his strength. When you are discouraged, when you are feeling like life is too much for you, the journey is too hard, how long does it take you to turn to God for his perspective on your situation? Time is wasted when we wallow and we don't turn to him. And once we do, we say, why didn't I cry out to him sooner? So how long does it take you? And then do you truly believe that God is gracious to you in your weakness? Or do you beat yourself up when you are weak? God is gracious. Allow him to be gracious to you when you're weak. All right, now so we need to look at King Ahab. Not nearly as much fun as looking at how God met Elijah. Ahab in chapter 20 finds himself in trouble when Ben-Hadad and 32 other kings combined forces. Ben-Hadad wanted Ahab's treasure, his wife and his children. And it's interesting, Ahab doesn't even seem to hesitate. He says, okay, that's fine, you can have them. Wow, glad I wasn't one of his wives. He doesn't hesitate to agree. Well then, in verse 6, you wonder if he thought that, well, that was easy, maybe I'll go after a little more. And so in verse 6, it says he wants to search the palace and the homes of your servants and take what we want. Ahab decides to get counsel, and the counsel is no, do not agree to these demands. And the result of that is the stage is set for war. A prophet arrives and declares that Ahab, along with his junior officers, would defeat the enemy. Why? In verse 13 of chapter 20, so that you will know that I am the Lord. First offer of grace to the undeserving, so that you will know, see what I do for you that you don't deserve, that only I can do. God graciously gives an opportunity for Ahab to turn to him. And in verse 22, the prophet instructs King Ahab again, another attack is coming, so prepare. And on the other side, Ben-Hadad's people are concluding that the God of Israel is simply the God of the hills. So we can fight him on the plains and have victory. The prophet again declares that because they don't know the God of Israel is God of the whole earth, Almighty God, I will deliver this vast army into your hands. Remember, these are God's people. Though disobedient, they're God's people. And so God says, I'll deliver the vast army into your hands, and you will know that I am the Lord. A second gracious opportunity. And this time it includes the Arameans. Not just Israel, the whole world. God wants the whole world to know he is the Lord. God moves toward people who need to know him patiently, repeatedly, graciously, giving reason to believe. So King Ahab had two decisive victories Not because his army was bigger and stronger and better, because God was gracious. And God was gracious so that Ahab might turn to him. But Ahab wasn't interested in bowing in humility. He only wanted the benefit that God could bring. In verse 31, Ben-Hadad, his officials say to him, "Look, we've heard that the kings of Israel are merciful." Might have been an ancient version of misinformation. Did he know Ahab? Did he know Jezebel? Merciful wouldn't be what a descriptor I would use. But we've heard the kings of Israel. Let's go to the king of Israel with sackcloth around our waist and ropes around our heads. Perhaps he will spare our lives. At this point, Ben-Hadad, after two defeats, had no other choice at this point but to plead for mercy in sackcloth. And Ahab falls for this, unwisely allowing God's enemy to live against God's command. And God sends another prophet to Ahab and tells him in verse 42, he said to the king, "This is what the Lord says. You have set free a man I determined should die. Therefore, it is your life for his life, your people for his people." Sullen and angry, the king of Israel went to his palace. Ahab didn't deserve God's mercy. He was a bad king and he led people into sin. He was a wretch. God offered grace and mercy to him more than once. God is much more patient and merciful than we would ever be. I think sometimes people talk about the Old Testament and say, "Oh, I don't like so much judgment." But if anyone was worthy of judgment, I guess it would have been Ahab. But God is patient, persistent, and merciful, giving opportunities. He came to Ahab and Israel's rescue by giving them victory over an overwhelming enemy, showing God gives way beyond what we deserve. He gave victory. He sent prophets to speak truth and declare God's desire to be known. And still, Ahab showed no interest in repentance or turning to God. Ahab had the opportunity to turn his life to God, but he refused. And things get worse in chapter 21, where we meet Naboth, who owned a vineyard next to Ahab's palace. The vineyard had been in his family for generations, and Ahab wanted it. But his offer is politely declined. So like a spoiled child, Ahab goes home sulking because he didn't get his way. Ahab is a wretch, a man of despicable character. But his wife Jezebel is even worse. She manipulated. She found men who would lie for her, saying that Naboth cursed God, and he was stoned to death. Naboth was a man with righteous convictions, and he did not deserve to die for that. And this is a sad evidence. This is a sad truth that life is not always fair. Faithful missionaries and Christians suffer and are persecuted. But even so, even though that reality is true in a fallen world, we should never be discouraged by thinking that God doesn't care about it or he doesn't see it. So the great sin of idolatry has been talked about. It's no more grievous than the sin of injustice. And this was a serious injustice. The sin of injustice is the failure to love our neighbor. Idolatry is the failure to love our God alone, and injustice is the failure to love our neighbor. Both are rebellion against God's standard of righteousness. Injustice, persecution, and oppression are alive today, and these are the things that will bring God's righteous justice to bear on humanity. 21, verse 15. As soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned to death, she said to Ahab, "Get up and take possession of the vineyard of Naboth that he refused to sell you. He is no longer alive, but dead." Wow. When Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, he got up and went down to take possession of Naboth's vineyard. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, "Go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel, who rules in Samaria. He's now in Naboth's vineyard, where he's gone to take possession of it." This is what the Lord says, is what Elijah is to tell him. "Have you not murdered a man and seized his property? Then say to him, this is what the Lord says. In the place where dogs licked up Naboth's blood, dogs will lick up your blood." Ahab said to Elijah, "So you have found me, my enemy." Ahab had many chances to turn to God. And he hears this declaration of judgment. It's interesting to notice that Elijah's found his voice again. He's not afraid. He's pronouncing judgment on Ahab, which could be life-threatening. And then in 25 to 29, it says this: "There was never anyone like Ahab who sold himself to do evil in the eyes of the Lord, urged on by Jezebel, his wife. He behaved in the vilest manner by going after idols, like the Amorites the Lord drove out before Israel. When Ahab heard these words, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and fasted. He lay in sackcloth and went around meekly." Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah. "Have you noticed how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he's humbled himself, I will not bring this disaster in his day, but I will bring it on his house in the days of his son." If only Ahab had remained in that place of humility, in that sackcloth, with a contrite heart attitude, perhaps his life would have ended differently. Perhaps the life of his sons would end differently, would have been brighter. But God delays the judgment, and that brings us to principle two. God offers grace even to those who reject him. God offers grace even to those who reject him. He offers grace to all, but not all receive it. God is a God who moves toward fallen humanity with mercy and grace. God is far more patient and loving than we would or could ever be. He's ready to move toward anyone who casts their eyes to him, trusting him with their whole heart, even for a minute, right? But Ahab couldn't continue in that posture. But grace is an invitation to follow him. Elijah did. He accepted God's gracious refreshment, and his next assignment, he found his courage and his voice. Elijah was blessed and lived a fruitful life, sharing the truth of God with countless in God's family. Ahab, as a leader of a family and a nation of God's chosen people, put himself as the ruler of his life. And because he did not choose to accept the grace offered to him, his life on earth ended badly. And he would also face eternal separation from God. When you're tired, defeated, or full of doubt, remember Elijah and the way God sought him to strengthen him, refresh, and restore him with grace and mercy. And then, when you look at the wretch in your life, no one is beyond hope. As John Newton started out as a man of despicable character, grace was greater than his sin, and he was changed. Remember Ahab and pray for those who are resisting the grace of God. Ahab, for a moment, had a contrite heart, but still faced judgment for his wickedness. Pray for the power of grace to win those who have yet to bow before the gracious God of the universe. Remember Elijah in your discouragement, and remember Ahab in your witness and in your prayers for those who are still resisting God's grace. God offers grace to all, but not all receive it. Father, we thank you for your word, and we do pray that you would save those who are resisting your grace, that you would change things by your power, that you would use us to speak grace and mercy and truth into the lives of those who seem to be running from you. Surely their wickedness will find them out. And we thank you for the way that you encouraged Elijah. So now through the discussions, I pray the encouragement would continue, that you'd strengthen, refresh, and help us to set our eyes on truth and not our feelings. In Jesus' name, amen.